Would you like to play a game? Attention gamers, my name is Squid Wicked Freestyle, world-renowned hacker and NFT auteur. I will disrupt the entire world economy with absolutely no understanding of how it works or even what it does. Dogecoin, bitch, believe it. I'm here with a purpose. I'm getting video essays back on track. We need a body count in media consumption again, and I intend to provide that. I have lore spreadsheets to fill out. Like, what does Filmjoy even do? It sounds like a yogurt for film buffs.
Oh, actually, we provide a positive...
Excuse me, I'll be doing the terrorism around here, thank you. Let's talk TV. You know what I'm tired of? The term, the 90 Day Fiancé universe. Spoiler, it doesn't work out all over the universe. It's all the same shit. Like, get it together, Peacock, Paramount Plus, Discovery Plus, who has since merged with Warner Brothers. It's a real shit sandwich. Amazon Prime, Hulu, a subsidiary of Disney. Anyway, I got word that Film Yogurt was planning some introspective job drool to kick off the new year. So I'm giving the people what they want. A body count. Movies of Mikey, best of 2022. Let's go, clickbait. Pew, 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 pew.
Had the music ready to go. Okay. Okay. Early in Nope, we are introduced to this clip, a black jockey riding a horse from the Animal Locomotion series of photographs created by Edward Muybridge in 1883. The point the film is making is that we don't know the name of the jockey despite the series being a structural element of film history. That's true, by the way, we don't know his name.
But did you know?
The horse's name is Annie G, a thing history bothered to write down, so point immaculately well made. Nope is a film about OJ and Emerald, siblings that kind of run a business bequeathed to them by their late father. A film about the thankless aspects of the film industry and people like animal wranglers increasingly being replaced by CG. Thankfully, this movie uses real horses and fake monkeys. Nope is a movie with a lot going on. It's gorgeous in that once-in-a-lifetime experience in the theater kind of way. Hoyt Van Hoytema, the director of photography of this movie, see also Tenet and Interstellar to love his work more, invented an entirely new way to shoot night scenes, specifically day-for-night scenes. By locking a second infrared camera into an IMAX rig to shoot a second exposure in the same location, they could basically create the most stunning day-for-night shots I've ever seen. They are startling in this movie. Jordan Peele wrote, directed, and produced something we've never seen before, and in the sci-fi space and genre, especially pertaining to aliens, that's an incredibly difficult thing to do. A home run, and probably Jordan's best film. Okay, I talked about Nope. Is that...
Nope. Do another one.
Okay, if we're gonna talk about any tectonic theatrical release this year, it's impossible to continue to ignore the presence of the 900-pound gorilla in the room. So just keep going. You're nodding. Okay. The motion picture is back, baby. Directed by Joseph Kaczynski, written by an entire room of people, including Christopher McQuarrie, and starring a really well-cast group of young people that probably underestimated on some level how much Tom Cruise wanted to do something that no one has ever done before. Unparalleled, unprecedented, wildly enjoyable, blood pressure destabilizing, and somehow it's a worthwhile exploration of a pretty boneheaded character. It said meaningful things about how we process and deal and don't deal with grief. but also to get the true sensation of shaking a cockpit from air turbulence. They spent 15 months figuring out how to even get a camera in the jets in the first place.
I had to really teach them cinematography and the lighting so that they understood what's gonna look good on camera.
Gun angle's great.
A camera that the actors will have to turn on and off themselves while shooting and flying in the air for what could have been hours in the sky. To call Top Gun Maverick a production miracle is an understatement. This is an impossible production. With so many moving parts and safety protocols in place, any production less than one operating at peak efficiency could pull this off. An absolute blast at the movies. Top Gun Maverick is the real, real, real deal.
Talk about serial killers.
What?
Do you want me to talk about Scream?
Do tell me, Michael. Do you like scary movies?
You can't be the coolest kid in the room forever. Buckle up, actual hot take incoming. I think Scream 4 kind of bounced off a lot of people because it wanted to still be the coolest kid in the lunchroom while making commentary on a tectonic film industry shift it honestly had tepid commentary on at best. I still wake up in the middle of the night thinking about that dude wearing a Konami laser scope on his head. I can't. Taking the Scream franchise further, absent its creator and tone setter, is a monumental task. I sincerely did not have the highest of hopes that there would be a there, here, there, and then there it was, Scream. The reboot, cool five. It was a really solid year for franchises, and we will continue to learn absolutely the wrong lessons from these successes. Speaking of incredibly serviceable debuts from surprising directors who had something to do with a massive property, get ready, Matt!
I wrote fan fiction about Batman.
I'm laughing about something. Matt Reeves has been a definitive force in Hollywood for some time, making really interesting genre pictures. The dude directed the original Cloverfield, the unreasonably good Planet of the Apes sequels, and has quite the cinematic eye. Also, he directed 5 episodes of Felicity, so that one's just for you, Patrick. I think Batman is a character you really need to understand what you're trying to do with when directing one of these very large movies. In this movie, Batman's an emo baby who listens exclusively to Nirvana B-sides and My Chemical Romance. Keep the Black Parade going, my guy! In this world, Batman's already begun. When we start the movie, he's already Batman. Essentially, it's Batman Year 3. Bruce is a fragile, volatile, glass powder keg in this movie. He goes around calling himself
Vengeance,
and everyone makes fun of him for it. And then he hits them a lot. The takes on Batman's rogues gallery are interesting and insightful, a world packed with volatile people. Also, total chef's kiss to Zodiac Jigsaw Riddler. It all worked on me, so be sure to check this film out if you haven't already. It takes a lot to excite me about Batman anymore.
I really dug his old getup.
Yeah, I picked up on that.
Okay, talk about the blue people.
Okay, I didn't see the Blue People movie yet, I'm going to, don't freak out. But I think I saw something that scratches most of the same itches.
Is that right?
You're so close to my face. To call RRR an epic feels like a slight to the filmmaking of S.S. Rajamouli. RRR is an all caps epic. No qualifiers. RRR is also an entirely fictitious story of two real Indian revolutionaries who never met, but seriously, what if they did, because it would be a total bro down. Right? At its core, it's a movie based on, get ready for this one, The Motorcycle Diaries. the story of Che Guevara setting off on his motorcycle across the country and finding his calling. Okay, add a whole bunch of combat animals and the best dance sequences in a movie in a pinch, and you'll have some idea of what is going on in RRR. Sorry, Spider-Mans. I think RRR and Everything Everywhere truly brought the movie business back from the brink. The amount of effort and talent on display here is remarkable and worlds more than a wall-to-wall CGI fest that's aimed at no one in particular. Okay, you know who it's aimed at. So grab the biggest bowl of anti-colonialism popcorn you can muster and just have a great time at the movies. A movie with absolutely no restraint when it comes to glorious bombast, but at its heart is a beautiful exploration of friendship and duty. A glorious work with literally no equal.
What about something under the radar that probably some people missed?
Hey, how do you have a list of every movie we saw this year? Just curious.
I studied you.
Oh, that feels bad when you hear it, but also, I have a movie for you, I think. I mean, this movie puts you in a pretty wild headspace immediately. Quinn Shepard wrote and directed this movie that begins with this content warning. No notes! What follows is exactly what it promises. Cringe out of your school setups in this movie. It is the story of an opportunistic scammer, which resembles quite a few stories in our modern landscape. Overpromise, underdeliver, baby! Wildly prescient, this one feels, though in no specific celebrity's direction, though I think you could make some guesses. Simply a meditation that happened to be oddly clairvoyant on the continuing decline of the natural
world. Talk about the Twitter movie.
Ow. It feels kind of unfair to call it that.
Do it.
It feels like waltzing brazenly through a minefield when finding an avenue to talk about Rian Johnson movies. I assume that's just the way he likes it. A murder mystery that plainly engages with where we live right now. Rian's movies are meticulously constructed with so many tripwires that I'm just so dang happy that Johnson & Co. are carrying the freak flag of Agatha Christie so valiantly. Also, Rian Johnson movies have created an entire microeconomy in the online space, clickbaiting based solely on the associated keywords tab for his films. It's right there in the title. Glass Onion is a Beatles song recorded in 1968 at George Harrison's house, itself a reference to the band The Ivies, which John Lennon thought would be a good name for that band. Look, it's a song about reading too much into art and endlessly speculating on things meaning with no economical skin in the game. Sometimes artists just want to make art, and Netflix pays for it, I guess. Simple translation, John Lennon would absolutely detest Miles Braun with every fiber of his being.
Serenading me with my song.
On the guitar Paul wrote it on. I know, legit, right? But look at your face, it was worth it. Oh, my friend!
It's like when any celebrity brazenly uses a song they have absolutely no understanding of, leaving us in the liminal space of cringe sadness. And we can't move on without mentioning the continuously heroic work of Steve Yedlin here.
Are you going to do an episode on it?
Yeah, I get it. Sure. We'll announce that there's a plan to do that, yes. I mean, the design in this movie alone is worth writing a book on. Also, Jenny Egan shot for the moon and crashed through it with the costumes in this movie. I adored this movie. And I find that it blossoms with every rewatch.
Okay, I have a silly question.
Okay, sure. I'm sure this will be...
Is Pinocchio in the public domain or something?
Right, wow, just right into it. The works of Guillermo del Toro films are films you can watch over and over, finding new levels of appreciation as you venture down the rabbit hole. GDT's collaborator here is Mark Gustafsson, a name famous for two things, the PJs, hell yeah, and being a writer for the 1989 California Raisin show. In a year of, quick, make a Pinocchio film, even though it entered into the public domain sometime in the 1960s, this film stands strikingly alone. It pays homage to the Carlo Collodi book that inspired it. It just places the story in 1930s fascist Italy. Yeah, the movie goes places. And it's never not striking and glorious to look at. A glorious and beautiful stop-motion animated film and a monumental home run in what is a slowly disappearing art form. Mother Ben.
Yeah. Art. Do the movie with the butt plugs.
It's not like I just have a whole other video essay just prepared waiting to go. I actually already did an episode on it, if you want to check.
No new content.
A thing I didn't really talk about in my piece is the film's presentation of the two sides of the coin. The googly eye and the nihilism bagel are two representative sides that can be both equally toxic in large doses. Maybe finding our joy in life is about taking it seriously when we need to and being more relaxed and accommodating to those around us instead of constantly tearing everyone down, because the misery is born in ourselves and from our own trauma.
And the action?
Oh, buddy, the action. A triumphant melding of Hong Kong action cinema and b-boying brought to unbelievable chaotic heights that ultimately served the story and the action. Just brilliant. But Everything Everywhere All at Once is kind of about the fights you don't have.
That's profound. I'm kind of sorry I kidnapped you.
Cheer up, Charlie. There's more content to be made. Prey is a 2022 film directed by Dan Trachtenberg set in 1710s colonializing America. It's not a prequel to Predator, it doesn't fill in any grand swath of missing information. It's simply the story of a healer who desires to prove himself and become a hunter. And oops, you're fighting a predator. Sorry, did you not get my text? But that's really all set dressing. The lead I buried is that this film f***ing slaps the bad taste of every arguably distressing Predator sequel ever out of your dang mouth. This movie rules. End of. Amber Midthunder gives a star-making performance as Naru, a Comanche herbalist who knows she can bring the same level of nuance and care to the act of hunting to survive. Enter Prey, a perfect action movie.
More!
This one will be quick. I loved Emily the Criminal. I love everything about the Aubrey Plaza Nizance. Sticking with that term, let's go! It's a really interesting movie that feels very topical to the moment we're in, so check it out. Without hyperbole, Meet the Fabelmans is the most 2022 movie to ever movie. Oh shit, that's a hyperbole. It's a lot of pressure, man.
Deal with it, nerd. Start again.
Hey, you're the one taking hostages. It's not my dime. I think Steven Spielberg's Meet the Fabelmans is a shockingly layered look through the metaphor lens at a bunch of things that are 100% true. The last scene of this movie actually happened. It is worth the price of admission alone. You're welcome. If you want a deeper look at the profound nature of this film, it's a nuanced and gentle look at the situation that could be seen as quite ugly. And its central character, literally baby Steven Spielberg, lives through some hardship and good old-fashioned 1950s anti-Semitism. A portrait of a society actively propping up the soldiers of the Second Great War as heroes and simultaneously engaging in open and celebrated anti-Semitism. Yeah, when you put it like that, it's weird. It was a wacky time to grow up as a Jew in California. Thanks for the laugh track, that helped a lot. Perhaps it could lead someone to obscure part of their identity for a long time, ultimately making one of the greatest and moving pieces of cinema, like, ever. The cinematography in this film was done with longtime collaborator Janos Kaminski. Spielberg movies have always had a look to them, but here it's so much deeper. It's so strikingly gorgeous and at times painful to watch, sometimes both at the same time. Meet the Fabelmans is the new era of Spielberg movies where he's making some of the most beautiful and honest work of his career. In a year where a lot of movies were a celebration and a meditation on the act of filmmaking, Spielberg made the quintessential movie. This is where I came from and how I got here. Now you go. 1923 was a difficult year for the world. Let me just... Yeah, did not go great. Cool. More so in Ireland. In the midst of their own civil war is where we join this tale. And what a tale this is. Bring aspirin, you're gonna feel so many things. Martin McDonagh has been making incredible and quite strange movies for a spell now in Bruges, Three Billboards, etc. And we get the reteaming of Colin Farrell and Brendan Gleeson here as old friends living on a tiny fictional island called Inisherin. The film is breathtaking to look at, a different time, a different place, and yet somehow incredibly relevant to the world we live in right now. The encroaching nihilism of a world that does not support its people during a once-in-a-life rift in time. Is anyone safe? Is anyone happy? Bring a stuffed animal to watch this one.
Okay.
Whew, can't believe we got through the whole list.
Good, it's time for part two.
Wait, did we do a part one?
All right, I want you to sip right there.
Also, just real quick, did you hold me against my will just to do a, like, backdoor Fave 5 reboot of our existing concept? It's weird, man.
Talk about video essay stuff.
Honestly, I'm not even really mad about it. It's 2023, there's no rules.
I'm counting, you have 2 minutes.
All right, this is my first pick. I think this one's pretty easy. Everything Everywhere All at Once. Sometimes found family is the one you lose along the way. I mean, Everything Everywhere absolutely slaps. It really honestly deserves to be the movie that no award show sees coming.
All right, second choice.
Glass Onion. You know, I love a good murder mystery, even if the mystery twice in a row now is who gets murdered. Also, actors and crew speak about Rian Johnson's on-set creative environment cultivation as if it's second to none. He earnestly seems like someone who makes the job of making movies sound amazingly fulfilling and fun. He's a huge win for Hollywood and is actively dismantling the Hollywood superstructure that protects abusers from the inside.
That's two.
How much time do I have? Okay. RRR.
S.S. Rajamouli made a hell of an epic barn burner, and even if the rest of the internet tries to ruin things all the time, you can just enjoy an over-the-top celebration of Telugu action films for what it is.
Brilliant.
All right, number four.
Nope.
Nope. Nope.
Nope.
Nope.
Okay. I love Nope.
It's a film with an entire other story to illustrate, but never ceases to be a pitch-perfect 1950s sci-fi movie that brilliantly celebrates the art of photography.
Really, it's a film about itself. Outstandingly gorgeous.
One more to go and the clock is ticking. Tick-tock, 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 tick-tock.
Pray.
Come on.
I'm serious.
What a rare thing for an action sequel to understand an entire franchise so tonally and then give us an action movie not just unlike anything in the Predator franchise before it, but to make an American action movie about, forgive the parlance, actual Native Americans? And that voice of action cinema is proudly led by a voice that came from the same video game industry that I did, which is amazing. We know a lot of the same people, and even if I never met Dan Trachtenberg, I'm proud of him. So there's my list.
Now tell them to write something in the comments. Da, 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 da,
da, da, da. Like what?
Doesn't matter, but it spurs engagement. I thought you were a YouTuber.
Also, I'm pretty sure you should leave my house right now. I'm a little upset, and I don't like your general demeanor, and I hate your insistence that I should read your screenplay, so...
Oh, hello! Didn't see you there. If you want to hear me elaborate on why Nope is a cinematic masterpiece in video essay form, and you don't want to wait a month for it to come out on YouTube, there's a video essay up right now on Nebula.
Nope is a film that appreciates the art of filmmaking. It wallows in and celebrates the imperfect people trying to corral this wild beast into a marketable product. Because at the end of the day, all you need is a camera that kind of works to be there before TMZ shows up.
Not now, TMZ!
I've said it before, but movies are a miracle. Every time. The film literally climaxes at golden hour. It's about getting the Oprah show.
As you've heard, Filmjoy is now a Nebula First channel, which means that our videos go up there a whole month before they come to YouTube. Nebula allows us to upload our videos without fear of copyright strikes, which means the episodes that go up there are always the definitive versions, making Nebula the best place to watch Filmjoy. That's because Nebula is a platform by and for creators and is completely ad-free. They also have originals you can't find anywhere else, like Lindsay Ellis's We Don't Talk About E.T. After all, E.T. was one of Jordan Peele's primary influences on Nope. If you sign up for Nebula from our landing page, you will receive 40% off an annual plan and access to Nebula classes where creators host lessons on how they make their art. You can even learn from Patrick Willems on how to skip film school entirely. This and more, all for only $30 a year while directly supporting us. Thank you so much. What we do is not possible without your support.